Listen, some of your CDs.
Like what?
I'm not sure, but I went online and I know we don't have enough. Oh.
Should have had Jack.
Well, I think we'll get started. You're listening to some beautiful music. Written by, composed by, arranged by, orchestrated by our very special guest today, the maestro Gerald Wilson. Please let's give him a round of applause.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
My name is Kenny Burrell. I'm the, what am I? I'm professor of
the chief of
director of the Jazz Studies Program. But today, more importantly, I'm honored to be able to honor Gerald, the Kenny Burrell Archive of African American Music today is now going to honor its first inductee into the Hall of Fame.
Oh.
And that's Gerald Wilson.
Oh. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
And I'm so honored, and I can't think of a better person that would deserve this honor for multiple reasons, which I'm not going to go into all that because we're here to hear Gerald. But before I continue, I'd just like to thank our sponsors. First of all, welcome everybody, and thank you so much for coming out and being a part of this. But I want to thank our sponsors. First and foremost, the Center for Afro-American Studies and Dr. Darnell Hunt here, who helped put this together. Along with Alex Tucker sitting over there very quietly, who's putting it all, got all the things together for us. The Friends of Jazz, which I see at least one representative here. Our Vice Chancellor, Dr. Claudia Mitchell-Kernan, is a member of the Friends of Jazz, as am I, and so we thank you and the Friends of Jazz. The Department of Anthropology, I don't know if anyone is here from that. You are, what am I saying, you're an anthropologist as well. The chair is in on I don't know if it's sabbatical, but he's in Italy right now, and so he's over there. But I know he would be here because he's a big fan of Gerald's. And finally, Claudia again for the graduate division for your constant support for the center and for jazz. So, without further ado, I have asked my very good friend and other special guest, who is probably, I know he's one of the premier people on the radio these days, but he has made K-Jazz one of the premier stations, not only in the United States, but in the world for jazz. So please welcome Bubba Jackson. And so I'd like to welcome everyone, and the way we're going to do this is Bubba has consented to join me and kind of put Gerald on the hot seat for a little while and ask him some questions and just have him talk about his career, which is illustrious and it's beautiful and it's long and it's still going on, and we love him. So, Bubba, if you had a question to start with, I'll follow you.
Okay. When you think back about African American experience in this country, the military was at one point not receptive to African Americans, Black Americans joining the military. Here's a man who did. He also joined the Navy. And I'm like, how did he get in the Navy when they didn't want anybody else? And I mean, it was always something that was important to me. I mean, by the time I came around, and you know, they were taking everybody because they needed bodies. And World War II, you know, as a part of that. And if you look at Central Avenue, I'm from Harlem. So we were in this isolated thing. And then as I got into jazz quite later on, I discovered Central Avenue. Okay, there's a Harlem over here. And the history of that is this man and all the folks on there came up with this sound that came out of Central Avenue. Segregation had its best points. When they kept us away from them, we developed something that we gave the world. And the world has not been the same since. And it's called jazz. Oh. This is an architect of that sound. I consider myself a student. I was just telling Gerald early, I played something by him on Pacific Jazz. I'm like, you know, I could be in this business for another 50 years and still never get all of your music. You know, because in playing it, there's so much out there. So my question is, how did you get in the Navy? What'd you do in the Navy? And then let's talk about what happened on Central Avenue pre-World War II and then after World War II, because there was a change. We lost that isolation and we lost that thing that belonged to us.
Okay.
So your Navy career, it's always been a curious thing for me.
Okay, well, of course, I was inducted into the United States Navy, and I was with a special group of people inducted into the United States Navy. In fact, there were no blacks at all in the United States Navy at that time. And of course, the way the story goes is that Mrs. Eleanor Roosevelt told her husband, who was the president of the United States, that the Army is integrated, and the Marines that have integrated, you've got to now integrate the United States Navy. So how did I get there? She says it has to be a jazz band.
Hey.
She said it.
At last.
It has to be a jazz band. And to do that, they handpicked all of the musicians that were to be in that band. So when I got inducted in Los Angeles, I got inducted right here. By the way, it's very historical because some great guys took me to the induction center that morning. One was one of the greatest trombone players in the world by the name of J.J. Johnson. In fact, he's the number one trombone player in the world. And a fellow named Freddie Webster, who was one of the greatest trumpet players in the world, who actually replaced me with the Jimmy Lunsford band. And so the doctor says to me when I got there, he said, wow, it says no matter where you're inducted, you are to go to the Great Lakes Naval Training Station in Great Lakes, Illinois. And that's how I got into the Navy. Now, the double barrel question. Central Avenue, wonderful place because at that time, as you say, segregation was at its best. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was really something else. Because a black in Los Angeles at that time, and I came here in 1940 with the Jimmy Lunsford Orchestra, which was one of the, actually, the Jimmy Lunsford Orchestra was the number two jazz band in the world. Duke Ellington was number one. Jimmy Lunsford Band was the number two band. They even replaced Duke Ellington in the Cotton Club, where they were sensational. Well, anyway, Central Avenue was really beautiful because it had the prettiest hotel in the United States that a black could go into. Mm-hmm. They had nothing in New York to even touch it for blacks or any other place. So you got this beautiful hotel. You got the beautiful coffee shop. You got the beautiful dining room. The rooms are just immaculate. And the people that owned it and ran it were those kind of people. You had to really be on. You couldn't go in there unless you were a person of goodwill and stuff. You couldn't just drop in there and sit down in the lobby, you know. Boom. Anyway, so this was all a plus. We were playing here with the Lunsford Band right out here in Culver City, where we broke all records, by the way. Everywhere we played, we broke records. And this was a wonderful place. Blacks couldn't go in the club there where we played. It had been a club, it's right over here in Culver City, that was called Sebastian's Cotton Club. Mm. Notice Cotton Club. Cotton Club in New York. Blacks in the black neighborhoods, but you couldn't play, you couldn't go in there. So anyway, the Lunsford Band, we did very well, and it was very nice playing for the people of Los Angeles, because you get so that you live with what you live with, what you have to live with. So we played here, we played at the Shrine Auditorium, and we packed it with people. The next day they had a special dance at the Shrine Auditorium, where they had a big riot. In fact, we only played about three numbers, and after those three numbers, this big riot started, and so it was, the dance was over.
What was the riot?
I don't know what happened there.
You got them excited, huh?
I think we just got out in time. You know, they'd had one burning of a...
What year was this?
This was in 1940.
Okay.
1940.
Was it segregated or?
Oh yes, it was segregated. The club, you couldn't go in the club. You couldn't go in there when it was Sebastian's Cotton Club. Couldn't go in there then. So anyway, now it was called the Casa Manana. They had named it the Casa Manana. We played there a number of times, and all the big bands started playing. And somehow or other, it seems as though all of a sudden there, it was not segregated anymore. This happened in the 40s. Didn't have any thoughts. Actually, I played there with Benny Carter's band, and actually played with Les Heights' band too, who had played there when it was Sebastian's Cotton Club. Well, I don't want to make these stories too long, but as I said, the town began to be stretching out. We came back in 1941 to make the movie Blues in the Night for Warner Brothers, which was a big, big time movie. And everything was always beautiful when we came here to Los Angeles. So I loved it. I made it my home at that time. I said the morning I got here, I said, this is where I'm going to come and live. Yes, I had lived in Chicago. I had lived in New York. I had lived in Detroit, Michigan. It gets so cold there. I went to school there for 5 years, you know, with the back, you got your instruments, you got to have on everything to guard you from that weather. So, and we left Chicago, and we got here. Chicago was 24 below when we left. And when we got here, the sun was shining, and it was warm. And I said, now this is the place I'm going to live. And I can tell you truthfully that I've lived by that, because I have lived two-thirds of my whole life in Los Angeles. I've lived here for 60 years. So I'm a real Los Angeles person. And Coast Central Avenue, the rest is everything. In fact, here we could break it a little bit. If you don't want to know how Central Avenue got, I can just show you my little bit here that I got when I here. And let's see. I'm looking for something here. What's this?
Who's it by?
Oh, naturally.
Is this Lecture?
No, that's not it. There's nothing more in there.
Well, tell me the artist and I'll look.
It's my band.
Your band.
Yeah. Well, I think I better look at here. Anyway, the reason I said that is because I formed my first band right here in Los Angeles.
Here's your band.
You got my band right there?
It says Orchestra Portraits. Is that the one?
No, that's another one.
Because I have a few with me, too, in case you didn't
know. No, I got it here. But I want to tell you about this number. My band, I formed my band here in 1944. And by 1945, we started traveling over the United States. We went all the way across the United States. And we went over there a couple of times. You mean to tell me it's not there?
Which one is it?
It's a jazz classic.
Jazz classic, your band.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Let's see. This is the Complete Pacific.
No, not that.
Not that one.
No, not that. We got to open this bottle. Just no. It opens this way now. Okay. Pull this zip over there. I pull this one over here.
Too many albums.
Now wait a minute.
We did a lot of albums. They all good.
Okay. Amen. Now there's some albums in here. Any albums in here at all?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
No, those are
oh,
yeah.
What's that?
Mm-hmm.
What's that?
This is it.
That's it?
Yeah, that's it.
This is my first album.
Okay.
Made right here in Los Angeles. And this would be in 1945, if you see on the label.
Oh, yeah, I see it, yeah.
1945. I want you to put on a number there.
I'll do it for you.
This is a number composed by the great Dizzy Gillespie. Dizzy Gillespie is a person I had known for many years because he came to Detroit when I was in school and spent 3 months in Detroit. We spent much time together. We both were trumpet players. We both were writers of jazz composers. We were both arrangers. So we really hit it off good and remained that until he died. I actually played in his band in 1950. And not only that, I wrote for him long before that. But here you will hear my band in 1945, and we were so tough that when I hear it today, I don't believe it. All young musicians from Los Angeles here, all from Los Angeles, had a couple of guys that were here, and they were, well, one guy that's been, we were together for all our life. In fact, we played with Jimmy Lunsford together when we were both 18 years old. And so he'll be on this record. His name is Snooky Young. Yeah. Snooky Young, of course, you know, played with Count Basie 10 years. Then he played with the Johnny Carson Tonight Show Band for 30 years. So you know he's rich. Yeah, you can't play on that 30 years and not be rich. Anyway, I want you to hear my band. This is Dizzy's tune. It's one of his toughest. It's his first one he recorded. In fact, he recorded in 1945, Dizzy did, and he heard my record in 1945, right after he opened at Billy Berg's. This is really history here. He opened at Billy Berg's, and at the end of the evening, after that, he, Charlie Parker, myself, and a man by the name of Norman Granz all went over to a friend's house to play my version of Dizzy Gillespie's His Own Groovin' High.
Okay, here we go.
This is it. This is a young trumpet player by the name of Hobo Dawson out of the Navy Band. They are perfect, as you can see. This is Eddie Davis from Los Angeles. He's still living, lives right here in Los Angeles. Wonderful tenor player. My piano player, 16 years old.
But you used him, because he could play.
Ooh, yeah, I mean, he was already, you know. He came from a jazz family. Teddy Buns, that's his nephew there.
Teddy
Buns' nephew. A little bit of stuff for the... Yeah.
This is interesting.
There you go. That's a trumpet. This is a trumpet. Here they go. We were already out there. cause that had never been used in big band jazz before. We learned. Okay, thank you. Thank you, thank you.
You know, Gerald, I was talking to Bubba earlier, and I just admire, I tell him how much I love his work on the radio, and I know him like I know you. And I said, Bubba, where do you get all that energy from? And he said, the music, man, music gives me the energy. And I'm looking at you now, and I see you when we've worked together, and when I'm just looking at you on the stage, and I know you, and I know how old you are, but you're like a kid when you come with this music. And it's just so wonderful, you know? And this is not a new piece, this is something, but you're still so involved with these sounds and these chords and these arrangements and these musicians. It's just a wonderful thing to see. And I don't know, this is not a question, this is just a comment, but I know that this passion you have for music is extraordinary, and some's got it and some ain't, and you sure have. I don't know, I wanted to ask you some questions, and I guess it'll be preceded by a comment about the fact that you have, through these various decades, you have managed to stay very modern, no matter what's going on around you. And can you comment on what gives you this curiosity or this interest in it?
The drive.
Yeah.
Well, I guess I can. See, when I joined Jimmy Lunsford Band, I had just come out of Cass Technical High School in Detroit, Michigan, your home, as you know, and my home too.
Right.
They treat me as a son.
Right.
In fact, we'll be there together in just a couple of months or so.
Yeah, we'll
be there. But I had attended this school, which was the number two school in the United States for music. Juilliard was first. Now, Cass has been into operation for 100 years, and Juilliard has been into operation for 106 years. Now, our music department, we felt would have been better, but we had everything. We had them beat because they've been 106 years, but they've only had jazz for 6 years out of that 100 years.
Plus, Cass Tech is a high school.
Yeah, right. Plus, and we could play everything. You couldn't get in the school, first of all. You had to go there. You had to know how to play your instrument before you got there. I had already studied in Memphis, Tennessee for 3 years. I actually studied at the same school that Jimmy Lunsford had been a teacher at one time. So I studied there, had a great teacher. By the time I got to Detroit, I could already read. I already knew how to read music. My mother started me on the piano when I was 4 years old, as she did her other son and daughter. So she was a music teacher, she was a school teacher. So I was kind of like born in a school almost. That's sometime I can actually remember now. It shows you back when I was a kid, and she'd have to take me to school with her before I was enrolled in when I was about 4 years old, you know? And I can kind of remember being in the school because my mother would be teaching, and I'd be so glad to watch her at work, you know? But anyway, Detroit, I made it right off. I could play. Guy said, play this, boom, 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 okay. Put another tough one up here for you to read. Boom, boom, okay. Now, my schedule now to study. First class in the morning, junior band. This is my first year there. In 1934, I started school there. And another thing, while I'm talking about our hometown, it was the greatest city in the United States because everything that they're talking about was being done in Detroit. When I got to Detroit, my mother, who sent me there to go to school, I thought I was going to go to a segregated school. And when I got there, there were all these different people at Cass Tech. And right across the street, as you know, on Vernon Highway, was Commerce.
Right.
And it was integrated. Northwestern was integrated. Northern was integrated. Eastern was integrated. Miller, all of the schools in Detroit were already integrated. Another big fact about Detroit, I got to talk about it a little bit to let you know what it was like. All of the big theaters, see, in New York City, blacks couldn't go to all the theaters on Broadway. But in Detroit, you could go to all the theaters downtown. The public parks, Belle Isle, which was the biggest and largest, is still there. And everybody went to Belle Isle, no matter what color you were or whatever. So Detroit had given me everything. It had given me the thing to know what freedom was about. They had some segregation going, but they tried to make it better. Like at the Greystone Ballroom, every Monday night was Black Night. And you know who you're gonna see? You're gonna see Duke Ellington, you're gonna see Chick Webb, you're gonna see Erskine Hawkins, you're gonna see Fletcher Henderson, you're gonna see Don Rem, you're gonna see the greatest bands in the world. And that's one of them will be there on that Monday night. So I wanted to let you know that about Detroit. However, like I said, by studying hard, I studied very hard, had to study harmony, had to study piano again, had to study percussion, had to take a string instrument. But before you could graduate from school, you had to take one string instrument. I took viola for a year. So if you're studying hard, I'm studying orchestration and harmony. And by the time I got out, I had just got out of school, and I got this wire from Jimmy Lunsford to join the second greatest band in the world. And I did, so I made my second arrangement was a big hit for their band because they had never heard arrangement quite like this. I had some unique harmony going on, and I had some other things going on in about it. In fact, I had one thing that was going on, and it's so good that Stan Kenton's band started using it, just my introduction to what I was gonna write, and made a big hit for his band. He called it Intermission Riff, though. I have that here if you'd like to hear it. It's called Yard Dog Mazurka. The reason I named it that, I have no reason to name anything Yard Dog Mazurka, but there was a young Jewish lad who also wrote for the band, the Jimmy Lunsford band, and I was at his home, and I said, "Hey, Roger, listen to this introduction I got. I'm writing an arrangement on Stomping at the Savoy." And he said, "Okay, play it for me." I played it for him. He said, "Oh, that's nice." He said, "That's really good." He said, "Why don't you just do that again, what you already have there? Put yourself a bridge to it. You'll have a whole number. It'll be your number. You'll get all the royalties off of it and everything." And I said, "That sounds like a good idea. You know, really good idea." So I said to him, actually, it wasn't the first one that I wrote for the Lunsford. It was the second one. My first one was also a hit for them, because I was using some harmonies that they had never used before. And so did you see it there?
I got it.
You got that? We're going to put it on now for you. Okay. Mm-hmm. I play the trumpet solos. I'll point them out to you. This would be the bridge that I put in. Mr. Brad. Put in a little syncopation. Got to know your chords.
You got your mute in there, right?
Got my mute, plunger mute. We hear a little bit of Willie Smith here. Now we're going to hear a little bit of Snooky Young. He's my buddy. And watch him pop this note for you. Not that one. Start out my little thing with the bones here. Then make a pedal tone here. Bring in the reeds. Little trombone. That's Elma Crumley. Bring in the trumpets. We'll take it into the bridge. Our guitar player.
What's that?
Listen. Good player. Al Norris.
Al Norris.
Yeah. We're getting ready to go on to the last chorus here now. You got to be a hell of a trumpet player to play this. Now we're gonna do some stuff. We're gonna do some stuff. Thank you. That's some tough stuff.
You got a lot of stuff.
That's the Lunsford band. I tell you, we were so we could outdraw any of the bands, by the way. We outdraw any band. Right. No band could outdraw the Lunsford band. After we made Blues in the Night, it made it worse than that. I mean, it's just too much. We had to make him take a vacation and all that kind of stuff. Really great band. Okay, let's see what we're going to do for him. What do you want? What do you got? What do you got? What do you got? Okay.
The arrangements on these two tunes that we just heard, was anybody else doing what you were doing?
At that time?
Mm-hmm.
No.
You know, when there's a lot written about jazz was coming out of New Orleans, and a lot of guys going up to Chicago, and they were trying to write for the orchestra, and they couldn't quite get the small group sound into a big thing. And what I'm hearing here, in 2008, it's still fresh. The way you use the horns, the bones, in that way, and the bridge, the whole nine, I mean, it's just, you don't find people writing like that. And I think there's some folks that are still trying to figure out how you did that.
Well.
I mean, because you wrote the book.
Yeah.
Period.
But I'm going to just make it real short. As I said, I was always a guy looking. See, I came up during my contemporary was Dizzy Gillespie and Charlie Parker. Dizzy Gillespie is older than me, so we're contemporaries. So I was always trying to move on. Even when I was with Jimmy Lunsford, Snooki and I, we'd be up at Minton's every night and listen to all of the stuff that was going to happen right there. So we were always there. Anyway, I was always trying to move ahead. I have a little thing here I can put on to show you what I was attempting to get to. I think if I can find it right here. Kenny, if you would help me here. I was wanting to get to the place so I could really make me some money writing, you know. So I started writing for people. I wrote my first two arrangements for Duke Ellington, actually, in 1947, right here in Los Angeles. And he knew me from being a school kid at Cass Tech in Detroit when he met me there. I was just a kid. He told me to keep on trying and keep on doing the best you can and everything. But then by that time, he knew that I could write. He called me up and said, I need a little help, Gerald. And I said, well, how could I help Duke Ellington? You know what I mean. But anyway, he says, yeah, I need a little help. We got to record, and I need you to do a couple of orchestrations for me on a couple of my songs. The first song that I did for him was a number called You're Just an Old Anti-Disestablishment Arianismist. The second one was a number called You Gotta Crawl Before You Walk, featured Ray Nass on the vocal, and if you want to hear it, it's in print now, it's all in CD. But I wanted to get so I could write, do anything I wanted. Duke Ellington, he called me to do a couple of numbers for me about 9 years later. 9 years later. And I said, well, okay, Duke, this time, I said, what do you need done? He said, well, I need a couple of numbers. And on the other one, he said, I need them tomorrow, when he told me. I had to get them ready by tomorrow for Columbia Records. On this one, he called me at 6 in the morning, and he says, Gerald, I need a little help. He was now with Capitol Records. And I said, well, okay, Duke, if I can help you, what do you want me to do? He said, well, I need two arrangements. I said, well, when do you need them? He says, I need them 2 o'clock this afternoon. Wow. Well, by that time, my wife, who is sitting right here with us, she was doing all of my copying, because we were getting the family, and the family was getting big, need to make more money. So I told her one day, I said, I just handed her my score. And I said, now you've learned to put everything you see here down on this paper. And she did. She became one of the finest copies. She copied for all these people for me. Ray Charles, the first country and western album, she copied it. She copied all the stuff I wrote for Duke, and I wrote for anybody else. She copied it, so we'd get the money. That means that I would get it for arranging and conducting, that's two, and also for the copying. So that meant I got all the money coming my way that you can get, you know. So anyway, though, but I was getting to the place, I wanted to get to the place where I could, Duke, when he asked me to write those two that he needed at 2 o'clock that afternoon, I'm going to show you how easy. And this is the way I wanted to write for people, and let them know I could do it like that.
The first one is Smile?
That's it. Okay. This is Charlie Chaplin's number called Smile, man. You can hear. Paul Gonzalez, Duke, little trombone, little clarinet. Baritone, little ensemble. Oh, Ray Nance. Bringing some saxes. Little brass. Harry Connie. Ensemble heavy. Connie. Little Cat Anderson. Woo, did you hear him do that? Can you believe that? Of course, Duke puts his really touch on the end, Maestro. Thank you. Well, You know, since we did that, we should move on. Although you can hear the other number. That took me about 45 minutes to write that number. And it took me about 45 minutes to write the next one, if you'd like to hear it.
Okay.
Let's put it on. Let's let it go.
Yeah.
This is called, this is just an old pop tune going around in those days called If I Give My Heart to You.
Oh,
that old thing. Yeah, that's the one. That's the one. But it's all right. Oh, no, you skipped that. Ooh, that's Ella Fitzgerald, though, singing my music.
Let me say.
Maybe it's not on.
Time for one more, and then I'm going to take some questions from the audience.
Okay.
So which one would you like to hear? Ella or the...
You know what? Hey, I'd like, we got Ella coming up later.
Well, no, we...
No. Okay, I'd rather let's hear Ella.
Okay, that would be
the one there.
Don't dream of anyone but me.
Okay. This is a number. Don't Dream of Anyone Me is the same number that Count Basie plays. It calls Little Darling.
Oh, boy.
Little Darling. They changed the name. Bobby Troup wrote some lyrics for it, and then they changed this one to Don't Dream of Anyone But Me.
Right.
Yeah. Real quick job, Hunter. J.J. Johnson. Neil Marshall singing it.
Along the line, I forgive you when a stranger puts your way.
Yeah, Ella. Ella. Ella Fitzgerald, yeah, she's beautiful. She's wonderful.
Great performance, great recording, great artist, Ella Fitzgerald, great band, great arranger. And that's Freddie Green, I believe, wrote the music on that.
Oh, no, yeah, Freddie Green, yeah, so Ray Brown.
Everything was just beautiful. And I just want to say that's, I'm sure you agree with me, that quality music. You know, as I was to say, two kinds, good and the other kind. That's the good kind. And I want to thank Gerald for continuing to produce that. I also want to thank Bubba Jackson and his people and others around the country that are keeping it alive. Because we need it. We need that. Otherwise, it's not going to happen. So thank you, Bubba.
Not a problem. I want to acknowledge one of my colleagues here, and we are happy he is back home at K-Jazz, Laura Downs.
Who's that?
Laura Downs.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to have you back, man.
Yeah, when he left, I cried. he's back in the box. That Ella Fitzgerald tune that we just heard, what year was that done?
That was done in the 70s. In the 70s, yes.
It doesn't have a date on here, but you've got a memory like most people. Right. You got a better memory than most people I've ever been around. I've been around him a while because I was working with him, and I think at this point we have a few minutes to take a few questions from the audience.
Okay.
Anybody want to?
Gerald, aside from you and Snooky, who's left alive out of that Lunsford band? Do you know?
We're the only ones.
That's what I thought.
Wow. We're the only ones. And Snooky is the same age as I am, only I'm 6 months older than him.
The two of us danced to you at the Casa Mignogna.
Wow. You did?
Speaking of age, this year we're celebrating Gerald Wilson's 90th year.
Wow. Yeah.
And on July 30th at the Hollywood Bowl, there's going to be a very special concert honoring Gerald and Hank Jones, who's also going to be 90. And a bunch of us are going to come there and perform and salute our heroes, our maestros. Questions from the audience? Either one.
Okay.
Yeah.
You played with a lot of your musicians. My interest is in alto sax. And I always had the idol of probably the better one, being Johnny Hodges. What about Willie Smith, who I thought was terrific? Marshall Royal, who I thought was very good. Cannonball Adderley. Could you give me a little taste of how you felt about those people?
Well, all of those were the greatest I've ever heard. Each one's the greatest I've ever heard. Willie Smith, but I like to just comment on Willie Smith. He was a great guy. He played with the Lunsford Band, and he was the guy that we all played for in the Lunsford Band, because Willie is the guy that's going to play there, and he's not going to miss anything all night. He's not going to make one mistake. And we all tried to play like Willie. And also, Willie was a guy that he could play with anybody he want, because after he left the Lunsford Band, he joins an all-white band by the name of Charlie Spivak. Right. They didn't know what Willie was.
But this is very important that you're hearing it from this primary source. I bet you, maybe not this crowd, but if you're a normal crowd, half the people wouldn't know who Willie Smith was. Right. Had no idea who Willie Smith was. But Gerald Wilson is saying, this is a guy we all looked up to.
Yeah.
This is an important part of this jazz heritage and jazz history, coming from a primary source.
But let me cut you on. You know who else thought he was the greatest lead alto sax player in the world?
Who?
Duke Ellington. When he came in, Johnny Hodges, and they each sat aside.
Right.
Said, Willie Smith, because Willie's not going to miss anything. And besides, Willie was avant-garde.
He could
play higher on the alto saxophone than they play him now.
Right.
Yeah, he was an amazing, and a great clarinet player.
And he was a good improviser.
Right.
Very good improviser.
Right.
So I just going to make a note, a little footnote to this idea about when you speak to somebody like Gerald Wilson, and like you say, there's only two left out of that lump of band. But you'll get some unusual truths coming through, like the name Willie Smith. I happen to have the pleasure of playing with him and knowing him.
Yeah.
But I'm glad to hear you say that for this audience, and that, you know, that means his name will stay alive.
Yes.
And Bubba, when you play, Willie Smith. There's so many things. Anyway, a couple more questions there.
Speaking of players, and of course, Maestro, you know I love everything, but one of my favorites of all time is Live at Marty's.
What was it?
Live at Marty's.
Live at Marty's.
And I happen to know, you know, and Bubba's probably found it, you know, even K-Jazz has a vinyl copy, and there's a big chunk taken out of the first tune on the edge of the record. But speaking of players, one of my favorite tunes has always been, and one of my favorite trumpet players has been Paper Man, Charles Tolley.
Yeah.
And never heard Charles again much after.
Well, you should have heard him this year because he got nominated for a Grammy.
I didn't know that.
He got a new record out with a big band, Grammy nominated.
Yeah, right.
He's doing fine.
And Paper Man was kind of a different tune for you at that time. It was a little bit out of the box. Well,
if you notice that night, I played other people in the band, played their music. I played a Harold Land number, however, that was my orchestration on it, but it's where it's at. Yep. Talking about the It Club on Washington Boulevard over there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Very good.
The Heart album is fine.
Yeah,
they were.
You know, Michael mentioned something about being outside the box. I kind of like that, actually. But how do we bring the love and the dance back into the music? Because people are not dancing to this music anymore. And that's how we keep it popular, by having that romance and the dance and the music. What would you suggest to the players of today to put the dance and the romance back into the music?
Did you hear?
Well, I heard what he said. But as he said, the people are not dancing that way anymore. And jazz is not that way anymore, because we're where we belong now. You hear us in the concert halls. You hear us in the Carnegie Hall. You hear us in nothing but concert hall, because our music is very difficult too. I mean, jazz is so difficult that you won't believe it. I mean, you can about God that plays the symphony art, he's great because he can play this thing. He's great, and he's not going to miss anything and everything. But like I say, in jazz, you man, a guy can take it and he can just go away and just thrill you by creating.
Right.
Improvisation.
Well, I'd just like to add something to this for what he's saying. And it kind of coincides with what you're saying about jazz being like classical music. It's evolving, and it's in the concert halls, and it's so difficult. But fortunately for us, we have these records that are preserved like classical music. It's here for people to dance by.
Absolutely.
A lot of the musical news that they can't do that, but we do have these records that are available, and thank you guys for playing it. This lady's been holding her hand up for ages.
Well, this young man touched on what I wanted to talk about, because it just makes me want to leap up and dance immediately. And now, it's not always provided for, and the conventional thing is to tap one's foot to nod one's head a little bit.
Uh-huh.
But what I'd like to get up, the whole body responding, because that music, I mean, music and moving go together, surely. For me, it's my way of appreciating the music, to move how this piece of music makes me want to move. But there's not much of that. The situations are not provided for that, right? So we lift, tapping our feet when we really want to leap up and get into it, the whole thing.
Right.
So,
any more questions?
I wanted to, asking part was, do you like to play for people to dance? Do you like to see people dance when you play?
Sure, I do. Yes, I came along during that period. Yeah, I love to see it, yeah.
They were dancing in Monterey this year when he played.
Yes, I still like to. I like that. Yes, yes, I do.
Okay, because
yes,
I have a feeling some musicians don't want you to sit and listen, Rob.
Although I can't dance.
Okay.
Worst dancer in the world.
But you do dance in front. I've seen you in front of the band. In front of the orchestra, you dance.
I think a couple of more questions.
Mr. Wilson, not including yourself, who would you rank as your top three trumpet players of all time?
Okay, well, I got some of them up here. I go, naturally, we're going to go in with the man who is really the top trumpet player. Not only does he play great jazz, and he's very creative because he plays a different way than he can play everybody else's way. In other words, he can play like Miles Davis. He can play like Clark Terry. He can play like Roy Hargrove. He can play like any of them. And that's Wynton Marsalis. And he can also play classical trumpet, which puts him in another world. Yeah, he plays these big concertos.
He's the only one to win Grammy for classical and jazz.
Right. And yes, right.
Only
and,
musician, period.
And he's still doing this thing because I just saw him. When I played with him at the Lincoln Center, and he was playing in the band, they played all my music. And he played one of my numbers that he had never heard before. And he played it like I had never heard it played before. And that was a number that we put in the world of Taurine, a number called Carlos. Carlos Arusa.
Oh, he played Carlos for
Carlos Arusa.
Oh, wow.
And Carlos is a number that I wrote for Matador. He was the greatest in the world. And I had a chance to meet him, and they asked me to write this number after he got killed, not in the bull ring. He got killed in an automobile accident. But anyway, they asked me. But Wynton Marsalis played it like I had never heard it played before. And we only went there one time, we ran down. The next time we played it, you know, and then he played it that night on the concerts, you know. He's a tough trumpet player.
Oh, yeah.
And he did so much for all the young trumpet players that's coming up, because they're all tough. Mm-hmm. That's the big five. They changed the whole world of trumpets.
Right.
They do everything on it.
Right.
They play those double B flats and way above that. Yeah, he can do it all. He can do it all.
Yeah,
he's a...
Give him credit.
And he's a wonderful, wonderful guy. He's still doing that, bringing in people and then keeping it going.
Who are the next two after Wynton?
After Wynton? Well, of course, you got Roy Hargrove. He's awful tough. Roy Hargrove. You got Terrence Blanchard. He's mean, too. He's got Wallace Roney. He's tough. Wallace Roney. You got them all. What's his name? The other little kid. I call him a kid. He's the youngest of the group. You know I'm talking
about. Oh, from Cleveland?
No,
plays with you, Sean?
No, Sean Jones. He's a new one on the scene. Sean Jones plays with my band.
Uh-huh.
By the way, could I plug my last three albums?
You can plug them.
All I want to do
is
don't want to do it. Just would you pick up my last three albums? They're on Mack Avenue Records.
Uh-huh.
The company is in Detroit, Michigan.
Uh-huh.
And I have one called New York, New Sound. The next one was called Time. In my time. And the last one, which is just called, was called the Monterey Moods, which has a commission number that I wrote for their 50th anniversary.
Wow.
And I had written that 40th already, and I had written the one before that. So I had written all the anniversaries they ever had.
I think Bubba would agree with me. If you want to hear some great music, particularly in the big band setting, you can't go wrong with Joe Wilson, right?
I got to say something.
Okay.
Let me interrupt. I must interrupt you.
You're going to interrupt me?
Yeah.
Your wife's got her hand up.
I know.
I'm just making a joke.
But no, look, I got to tell you this.
How about Lester Robinson?
Oh, Lester Robinson's great. Played in my band. Great writer and everything. I recorded his numbers, by the way, and he gets all of the royalties, has his name on there. Yeah. Anyway, I got to tell you about this man here. I didn't get a chance to meet him until in New York City when I was with the Ray Charles. And I went over and Eric Dolphin took me over and said, I want to meet Kenny Burrell. You were there at the state, at the place. I came over and met you and you shook hands. You were a very nice man. But before that, I want to tell these people, this is an innovator for the guitar, for jazz guitar. He has his own sound. He's as fast as they come. I mean, he can play just as fast as you want it. He can play with a lot of soul. He's a great composer in his own right. And I'm happy to have been with him now for 20-some years. And he treats me like a brother. Well, I just want to let you know that.
I think it's time for me to say a little, go back to the second reason, or one of the other reasons, main reasons we're here today. As I mentioned earlier, the Burrell Archive of African American Music has been established now for a little more than 2 years. Thanks again to Dr. Donald Hunt, whose idea that was, to associate it with the Center for African American Studies. And we decided to start a Hall of Fame. And our first inductee in that Hall of Fame is Gerald Wilson. And I'd like to ask Dr. Hunt to come up and make a presentation.
Great. Do you want to come to the podium?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Okay, doctor. Mm-hmm. Oh, he's over there. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Gerald, you come over
here.
Over here? There we go.
Okay.
Well, it's my distinct honor to today bestow upon Mr. Wilson the very first award in the Hall of Fame in the Kenny Burrell Archive of African American Music. And the award is affectionately known as the Kenny.
I didn't do that.
And let me read the award here. The Kenny Burrell Archive of African American Music proudly presents the Kenny to Maestro Gerald Wilson for a lifetime of great music and education.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm overwhelmed, of course. This seems to be my year for what do they call it?
Awards and accolades and awards.
No, but what award is this? Is the, I just got one of these about 3 weeks ago.
Oh, lifetime.
Life. Noel, it's if this was the Monterey Festival Hall of Fame.
Right, Hall of Fame.
Well, yeah, the Monterey Festival about 3 weeks ago. They presented me with the. Into the Monterey Festival Jazz Festival Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
So I got another Hall of Fame here,
yes.
And I'm sure overwhelmed, and I'm just deeply grateful. I don't know what to say.
Well,
and coming
are.
From you and UCLA and your organization, which you are doing so much here at the university. And you know I love it here at UCLA. I don't know what I'll do when I can't come here. But I love being here.
Well, we want you to come as
and I want you to thank. I want to thank all of you, okay. And I want to thank all of you today for the wonderful way you've treated me up here today. Yeah,
all right.
Yeah.
Brother, let's take a picture with Gerald. Let's take a picture with Gerald.
Okay. Okay. Right here.
Where's my man? Oh, he. We take a picture now.
He found out I was going to be in the picture, and he ran.
But I got the right side up.
And by the way, while we're doing it, there are some refreshments somewhere.
One more, please. One, two, and
Gerald Wilson.
Oh, man. Thanks so much.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that.
We appreciate you.
Thank you. Okay.
Okay. That sort of people might be interested, since Gerald mentioned Wallace Roney. I'm not positive, but I think he's playing this Sunday night at the Grand Performances, at California Plaza downtown. free concert.
Oh, yeah?
At 8 o'clock with a bass player named Ron Carter.
Oh, Ron Carter?
Yeah, and I'm not positive, but I think the two of them are playing. It's with a group of Indian musicians from India, and they're playing. It's called Miles from India. They're playing the music of Miles Davis.
Right.
All right.
Where Ronnie and Carter are going to be with them.
Yeah.
They have a new album out, and it's, you said Sunday, right?
Sunday the 1st, yeah.
Yeah, I think that's the day, yeah.
It's their first one. Grand performance. California Plaza, downtown.
Thank you.
What time?
Jill, I'm going to go online, you can find out the address and everything. Grandperformances.org.
Right. Yeah.
Do you want this in the bag? I'll put this in the bag, please.
Okay. Stuff here.
Okay, let's do it.
Good job with you.
Put that in.
Oh, yeah, I'll put this.
We're going to get a picture. Oh, I'm ready. You ready?
I'm ready.
Got it?
Yeah.
Joe?
Hey.
Joe, let me have that award back. They want to take a picture of it.
Okay.
Sorry.
All right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let me get that.
I study at Temple University with Terrell Stapp.
Oh, listen. Man, I love that guy.
Oh, yeah. He's the best.
Oh, yeah. I tell you.
I was just touring with Amsterdam.
Well, you were collecting
Which the one that
Clive is
the coach?
Listen. Look at this
screen. With Tim Warfield. Tim Warfield's a man.
That's the music that had a lot of natural dance. Definitely, you can't sit and listen. You gotta get involved.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I mean, high energy. Oh, yeah.
So, Joe, we need to take your picture.
Okay.
Let's take your picture first.
Wait,
he runs the program.
Don't leave Joe out of it. She's popular.